I'm Kirk Jowers, and I'm pleased to host the second episode of COVID-19 with Dr. Russell Osguthorpe. He's the Chief Medical Officer of doTERRA and a board-certified pediatric infectious diseases specialist. As long as COVID-19 is such a pervasive force in our lives, we will continue to do these daily and concise shows to help you get caught up and make sure you have the knowledge you need to make sense of everything that's happening. There's so much inaccurate information right now that the World Health Organization is calling it an infodemic. And the most telling example of how crazy things have gone,
I agree.
The WHO has joined TikTok to get the facts out and dispel COVID myths.
Wow.
So that is part of our job as well, is to give you only the most accurate information and do it in a concise way so that you can get on with the rest of your life.
I must say that the social media contribution to this worldwide pandemic of COVID-19 is something that we've never really experienced in infectious diseases and epidemiology. The contribution here is staggering.
Well, and you were talking about even as recently as 2009, when you were, of course, still an infectious disease specialist dealing with it, the number of people on social media has more than
doubled,
and and the impact in our lives. I've certainly seen it from my past life with politics.
Everything's different.
Everything's different. So as of 10 o'clock Central European time, there are 136,895 confirmed cases, 5,077 deaths, and 123 countries with cases.
It's a staggering number, but it's going to grow.
It's going to go north.
Testing is going to be ramping up in countries with very large populations, and we would expect to see those numbers grow over the next week.
A lot happens every day, and so one thing we promise to do on each episode is to get you caught up. Dr. Osguthorpe is going to tell you a little bit more about why it's good to get this in 2 minutes instead of 12 hours, but here we go. Life in some parts of the world has come to an utter standstill as countries try to reduce the impact of the coronavirus.
Italy, for example, is limiting travel between districts in Italy. It's quite remarkable what's happened in some places around the world to try and limit the spread of the virus and make social distancing even more powerful of a strategy.
Hospitals in northern Italy are overwhelmed, which will go to some of the reasons that they're trying to do all the things we're going to talk about. Mm-hmm. Closing all the Disney properties, Tokyo, Paris, U.S., wherever, Broadway theaters, huge attractions and museums, the Louvre, Eiffel Tower in Paris, all closed. March Madness.
Major sporting events.
Major sporting event. We initially thought worst case scenario was these major sporting events, soccer, everything else, would be played without fans. Now they're just canceling them all together.
Yeah, or postponing them.
Postponing them.
The Masters was postponed.
Right. Major League Baseball. Millions of students are now out of school as cities are closing schools.
Universities.
Churches. Mm-hmm. Strikingly, yesterday, Wall Street had its worst day since the Black Monday crash of 1987. Today, however, was the best day of stocks.
Oh, I haven't looked,
since
really?
2008. Yeah, I thought I'd give you a little bit of good news.
That's good. I've been so swamped taking care of the medical stuff that I've not even looked at that. It had a big day.
A big day. The biggest day since 2008. Huh. And so the indexes still ended the week with sharp losses, of course. Mm-hmm. But the roller coaster will continue on that. A ban on travel from much of Europe to the United States began today. And as the virus continues to spread, we're seeing a slow trickle of very public figures announcing their diagnoses or close contact with the disease. For example,
the president of Brazil.
The Canadian Prime Minister, Justin Trudeau's wife. Huge sports stars, on and on. We're starting to see this, which some people are asking questions about that with testing, but we'll get to that later.
Yeah, we'll talk about it.
President Trump declared a national emergency today. And in this, and as well as our foundational episode, which will come out on Monday, continued issues with the availability of coronaviruses.
It is a major issue.
And especially in the United States, seems to be one of the major places.
I'm so frustrated with the availability of testing in the United States. So many tests have been performed in other parts of the world, and so successfully, it is difficult right now to manage an epidemic in an absence of information that testing would provide.
It's a time for preparation, not a time for panic. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely.
These things that I just read and that you're going to talk about, all of these things...
Come back to social distancing.
Right, and potentially the difference between a tragic pandemic and merely a difficult one.
Yeah, so I don't want to take too much time because this has been talked out about ad nauseum.
Right.
But people need to understand that social distancing is incredibly important at limiting the spread of the virus. If we stay out of large groups of people, the viral transmission rates will go down. That's how epidemiology works.
Right.
So if we can limit the spread of the virus by avoiding large sporting events or church or large gatherings of people at any place, then we are going to limit the spread of the virus and slow the transmission of the disease. There's a lot of debate going on right now about how the virus is transmitted. Is it, we used to think only days ago that the primary mode of transmission was through droplets that are spread through coughing individuals. Evolving evidence is suggesting that people can spread the virus more efficiently than that.
Right.
And we're waiting for confirmation around transmission, modes of transmission, and how each mode of transmission, how infectious each mode actually is,
right,
or how efficient each mode of transmission is. So is contact on surfaces, coughing by droplet, breathing or close contact to somebody who is symptomatic, and other forms of transmission are suggested now in some of the data that's coming out. But we're gonna learn more about this. This is an evolving situation. Research is being done in virology labs in multiple countries trying to figure out exactly how this virus is transmitted and how efficient each mode of transmission is.
And you mentioned a real interesting fact today when we were talking in your office about coronaviruses have been around forever. Mm-hmm. So infectious disease doctors, specialists like yourself know how they work, but this is, of course, the novel coronavirus, COVID-19.
And we don't know how it works.
We don't know exactly.
We're figuring it out. We're learning, right? And we're
right.
Looking at all the data coming out of countries where the virus has been transmitting for longer. And so in China, a lot of our data is coming out of China and South Korea. And we're learning a great deal from that data. Publications will be coming out quickly. The worldwide scientific community is doing a great job of getting that data out as quickly as possible, and it's being digested, and recommendations will change as we see those scientific discoveries impact our recommendations. We'll change our recommendations as we learn.
Today, we will release our first foundational episode, which will talk about the basics of the coronavirus disease, what it is, symptoms, all of those things. So, any final advice until Monday?
The word or the phrase of the day is social distancing. We need to limit our contact with large groups of people, making sure that we slow the spread of this disease. Social distancing works. Above all other things, that some of the recommendations may come and go, but social distancing works.
Thank you so much, and thank you for watching.